To Sherlock Holmes, she was always the woman.
The woman, Watson. The most elegant, the most enchanting of her sex. Born in New Jersey in the year 1858, prima donna La Scala, Imperial Opera of Warsaw, retired from the operatic stage to live in London. The woman, Watson. Irene Adler.
I remain, Mr. Sherlock Holmes, yours very truly, Irene Adler.
It was in 1888 that we encountered her. 7 years had gone by since my own first meeting with Sherlock Holmes. Perhaps, in my humble way, I'd even enhanced his fame a little. Then I'd married and returned to medical practice in Paddington. But one March evening, returning from a visit to a patient, my way led me through Baker Street, and so towards the well-remembered door of number 221B.
Who is it? Oh, Watson, what a splendid piece of luck. I'm delighted, really. You're the very man I most wanted to see.
You're very kind, Holmes.
Oh, sit down, my dear fellow, sit down, the old chair. Oh, you can't think how lost I've been lately without my Boswell.
Oh, thank you.
By the way, you didn't tell me you intended to go back into practice.
But how'd you know I had?
You know my methods, Watson. If a gentleman walks into my room smelling of iodoform and with a bulge in his top hat to show where he secreted his stethoscope, I'd surely be very dull indeed if I didn't know he was an active member of the medical profession.
Oh, poor myself, Holmes, it's the old story. It's as clear as daylight when you explain it. And yet, I'd say my eyes were nearly as good as yours for observation, you know.
Oh, you think so, do you? Then pray make use of them now, Watson, and tell me what you see in this letter that has just come by special messenger. Read it.
They will call upon Mr. Sherlock Holmes tonight, a gentleman who desires to consult him. His recent services to one of the royal houses of Europe have shown that Mr. Holmes may safely be trusted with matters of the utmost discretion. He is not to take it amiss if his visitor wears a mask.
Aha.
Well, well.
Just so, Watson. Intriguing, is it not?
But what on earth do you imagine it can mean, Holmes?
Well, I have no data yet, and it's a fundamental mistake to theorize before one has some data. But the notepaper man, what do you deduce from that?
Well, it's very thick, tinted pink. Couldn't be bought for under half a crown a packet, I'd say, so the writer must be fairly well to do. It's rather a peculiar paper.
That's the very word, Watson. It isn't English paper at all, you see. Hold it up to the light and look at the watermark.
Large E, small G, large P, large G, with a small T.
Which stands quite simply for Gesellschaft, German for company. The P is for papier, of course.
And the EG?
For Egria. A glance at the open Continental Gazetteer on the table there will show you, Watson, that...
That it's the only city in a German-speaking country where the main factories are paper mills.
Yeah.
You've marked it, Holmes. Wonderful.
Not so far from Carlsbad and in Bohemia. Quite so, Watson. And since our distinguished visitor... But here he comes, if I'm not mistaken, in a brougham and pair by the sound of it, and a pair of beauties at that, I'd guess. Look, there, you see? 150 guineas apiece, those horses, or I'm no judge. There's money in this case, if there's nothing else, Watson.
And here I break my narrative for a moment to describe our singular visitor of that far-off evening. 6 feet in height, with the chest and limbs of a Hercules, a deep blue cloak lined with flame-coloured silk. An opulent and barbaric apparition indeed in our drab old England. And across his face, a black vizard mask.
The
You had my note, Herr Holmes?
I did indeed, sir. Pray take a seat and tell me whom I have the honor of addressing.
You may refer to me as the Count von Krumm, a Bohemian nobleman, sir. And this gentleman?
Oh, this is my colleague, Dr. Watson, upon whose honor and discretion you may completely rely.
Most certainly. I'm not in the habit of discussing my private affairs before a stranger, however discreet.
Well, in that case,
Sit still, Watson. You must confide in both of us or neither, Your Majesty.
What? Why should you think...
Watson, pray take His Majesty's mask. It is a needless inconvenience.
Yeah, you are right. I am the king. Why should I attempt to conceal it from your sharp eyes?
Why, indeed. Your Majesty had hardly spoken a word before I was aware that I was addressing Wilhelm Gottsreich von Olmstein, Grand Duke of Kassel Falstein and Hereditary King of Bohemia.
I have come incognito from Prague for the purpose of consulting you.
Then pray consult Your Majesty. The doctor and I are all attention.
The facts are these, then, gentlemen. When I was in Warsaw 5 years ago, I made the acquaintance of a lady whose name may be familiar to you. The adventuress Irene Adler.
Adventuress, Your Majesty? I know of the celebrated prima donna, of course.
And adventuress, gentlemen. I use the word deliberately.
I see. I take it, then, that Your Majesty became somewhat indiscreetly involved with this young person.
I did. I will not deny it. I was young. I was only the crown prince then.
And there were some compromising letters, no doubt, which Your Majesty wishes me to recover.
Precisely. But how did you know?
Because I know something of the world, Your Majesty, even sitting in this humble room of mine in Baker Street. There was no secret marriage or anything of that sort.
None, Herr Holmes.
Well, I fail to follow you, sir. If the lady should produce her letters for blackmail or any other purpose, how would she be able to prove their authenticity?
Do you think I did not ask her so, Herr Holmes, when I begged for their return? I asked her that very question. How was she to prove their authenticity?
But your writing, Wilhelm, it's so distinctive.
I could swear it had been forged.
Your private notepaper, Wilhelm.
Stolen.
Your seal, Wilhelm.
Imitated.
Your photograph, Wilhelm.
Bought. I will swear it all, Irene, and you are without the case against me.
You forget, Wilhelm. You surely forget, my dear friend.
What do I forget?
That we are both in the photograph together, hand in hand. Love, love, Wilhelm. And a little too much champagne, perhaps. Just a little. That magic, magic night.
Irene, you wouldn't dare to expose me.
No, Wilhelm. But I may consider myself to have been deeply wronged.
You can have half my fortune.
You promised it to me before.
I beg of you, Irene. I am to be married.
So I've heard, Your Majesty, to the second daughter of the King of Scandinavia. A most politic match. She will be enchanted, no doubt, when I send her the photograph.
Irene, you cannot.
On the day that your betrothal is proclaimed, my dear. That very day. Oh, Wilhelm, Wilhelm. Poor, compromised Wilhelm.
And I tell you that she will do it, Herr Holmes. If only you knew her, you would never doubt it for a moment. She always keeps her word. There are no lengths she would not go to rather than that I should marry another woman.
So it appears. You have made some attempts yourself, sir, no doubt, to recover the photograph.
5, and none successful.
And when will your betrothal be made public, Your Majesty?
On Monday next.
Oh, then we still have 3 whole days, Watson. It's really quite a pretty little problem in its own way.
You must place yourself entirely at my disposal, Herr Holmes. That my marriage should take place is of political consequence to all Europe.
I should be most happy to save all Europe as soon as I've dealt with one or two other small matters that are already engaging my attention at the moment. Good night, Your Majesty. Dr. Watson will show you out.
But do you promise me success? Your manner is somewhat casual, I may say.
If you leave me an address, I shall drop you a line.
You will find me at the Langham, under the name von Krumm.
Thank you. And as to money...
You have carte blanche. For immediate expenses, this bag contains £300 in gold and 700 in notes.
Oh, will you take charge of this, Watson? Just one more question, Your Majesty. The photograph you speak of was cabinet size.
It was. And you will surely require Miss Adler's address as well.
Well, it might be as well to have it, yes.
It is Brioni Lodge, Serpentine Avenue, St. John's Wood. Yeah. Gute Nacht, Herr Holmes, und Sie auch, Dr. Watson.
Good night, Your Majesty.
Thank you.
So began, then, our problem of averting the threatened scandal in Bohemia. I called on Holmes next evening and found him in the disguise of a drunken-looking horse groom.
Pass me my makeup tray, would you, Watson? And I'll tell you the whole thing while I remove the semblance of the inebriated Bert Stevens.
Then back to Sherlock Holmes.
Well, no, into someone else, I fancy. Yes, an amiable nonconformist clergyman, I think. That should serve admirably.
Really, Holmes?
Rather simple-minded, perhaps. White-haired and short-sighted. Now, look here, I have the whole outfit ready. You see, baggy trousers, broad black hat, egg stains on the waistcoat.
Oh, splendid, splendid. I suppose you want me to serve as your curate, even more simple-minded.
No, no, only as yourself, Watson. Hey. Oh, forgive me, my dear fellow, I didn't mean...
Well, quite sure. Now, while you're making up, tell me the tale of your adventures, Holmes.
Very well. It happened like this, Watson. There was I, Sherlock Holmes, got up as a horse coper, sitting in the pub opposite, watching Bryony Lodge. Of course, I stood the local cabby to a beer and soon got all the information I wanted.
About Miss Adler?
About Miss Adler. She's the daintiest thing under a bonnet, it appears. She's turned the head of every man in the neighborhood. Pass me the cold cream, would you, Watson?
Oh, does she have a great many male visitors?
No, only one. That's the very crux of the whole matter. One moment, I must just whiten my eyebrows. This visitor of Miss Adler's, Watson, a certain Mr. Godfrey Norton of the Inner Temple. Very dark and dashing, so my friend the cabby told me.
When you were the ostler?
Exactly. And while I was watching, our dashing gentleman friend rushes up to the house in a tearing hurry, stops there for half an hour, and then rushes out again shouting for a cab.
Drive like the devil, cabby. Gross and Hankies and Jewelers and Regent Street. Then the Church of St. Monica and Edgware Road. Half a sovereign if you do it in 20 minutes.
And a moment later, out of Bryony Lodge dashes someone else, Watson.
What? Miss Adler. You saw her?
Yes, at last. And it's true. What a lovely face. Though I only caught a glimpse of it through her veil, and she called a cab, too.
The Church of St. Monica in the Edgware Road. And half a sovereign if you reach it in 20 minutes.
On which, of course, Mr. Sherlock Holmes called a cab, in spite of his own somewhat disreputable appearance, and reached the church at precisely 12:05. Inside was a surpliced clergyman with Miss Adler and Mr. Norton. Norton, seeing me rush down the aisle, took my arm and cried,
"Quick, quick, my man, you'll do. 12:03 and the license expires, then. We need a witness to a marriage, man."
A witness to a marriage, Watson, my humble self. All done in an instant, tying up Irene Adler, spinster, to Godfrey Norton, bachelor.
Good heavens.
And a sovereign as a tip from the bride, which I shall wear on my watch chain forever.
Well, this certainly is an unexpected development, Holmes.
Indeed it is, my dear fellow. What's more unexpected, they parted at the door of the church, and I heard her say that she'd drive as usual in the park from 5:05, so all is well, our schemes can go ahead. There, now, black overcoat, yes, badly rolled umbrella. Oh, and hand me that little parcel, would you mind, Watson? Thank you. Now we are quite ready for our little visit to one of my most charming parishioners at Bryony Lodge. Good, good. Here we are, Watson. Almost there. Now let me give you your final instructions.
I'm all eagerness.
You don't mind breaking the law, of course.
Not in the least. It'll hardly be the first time in your company.
Very well, then. Now, whatever happens, simply do exactly what I tell you.
Do I ever do anything else?
You'll find rather a busy scene when we reach the house. I've already made arrangements. Some little unpleasantness, perhaps. A fight among some drunken guardsmen, for instance.
I take it there'll be confederates of yours.
Certainly. The street will be full of my confederates. I think I've engaged almost every out-of-work actor in London.
Oh, the place will be thronged, Holmes. What am I to do?
Just take this parcel, Watson. Uh-huh. Quickly, put it in your pocket.
But what on earth is it, Holmes?
A kind of bomb.
A kind of
bomb? Oh, pray don't drop it. Yes, Watson. It's just an ordinary plumber's smoke rocket, fitted with a cap to make it self-lighting when it's thrown.
And what do I do with this remarkable device?
Why, you throw it, Watson. You'll station yourself in the shelter of a laurel bush, which you'll find growing immediately outside the sitting room window. And when I'm inside the house...
But how do you manage to get in?
Just wait and you'll see. Ah, here we are. The house itself, and everyone ready in their positions.
Wonderful, Holmes. I've never seen a more admirably stage-managed effect.
Yes, observe the group of guardsmen, particularly Watson, stationed just at the spot where Mrs. Norton's carriage will arrive.
Those soldiers look spectacularly drunk.
Of course they do. They're my star performers. Now, there's the bush you have to hide behind. You see it?
The Daphne Loriola?
Oh, always so well-informed, Watson. Precisely. The windows open, as you see, and you'll be able to hear me say, "All I want is a glass of water, please."
Which is my cue, I take it.
Precisely. Then you throw the rocket through the window into the room and start to shout fire. The place will fill with smoke. There will be complete confusion. I shall reappear to join you, and then we shall return to Baker Street wiser than we came.
Wiser? What do you mean?
Miss Adler will have shown me where the photograph is hidden.
I can't believe it.
Aha, but here she comes, Watson. Look, that's her cab now. Get under cover, man, quickly, while I begin to play my part.
Good luck, Reverend.
Thank you.
Here, who give it you?
Sure, lie off me, will you? Please, down the Bluey Street, you
man, keep it alone, come. You
keep your hands on breathing in the kitchen, and you...
Gentlemen, gentlemen, I pray you to restrain yourselves. I beg you to stand back, gentlemen. Let the lady alight from her carriage.
Step aside there. How dare you create a disturbance before my house?
Next time, now, look here.
You can very well shut up for one now. Take that.
Oh, gentlemen, gentlemen.
Step aside, I say. Let me pass.
You shut your face, will you?
Gentlemen. Watch out, Reverend. You get hurt.
Oh, my head. My head.
Poor old fellow, he's hurt. My lady.
Well, what's wrong?
Oh, it's the old minister. He's hurt, my lady. We can't leave him a lion here.
Bring him into my sitting room, then.
Oh.
Poor old fellow, when he was only trying to help me.
Here, you, give us a hand, will you? Careful now.
Through this way. Watch the step, my man.
Oh, thank you. How very kind. Thank you, thank you. I'm better now. Please don't let me be any trouble.
Just lie quietly for a moment, sir. It was most good of you to come to my assistance. The wretches ran off when you fell.
You're very kind indeed, ma'am. All I want is a glass of water, please.
Certainly. I'll have it fetched for you at once.
Thank you.
Fire! Fire! Fire!
Fire! Fire!
Well, Watson. Good old Watson.
Well, I'm delighted, Holmes. Your team played their parts to perfection.
Well, so did you, my dear fellow. Oh. I knew I could rely on you.
So, you got the photograph?
Of course not, Watson.
What? Well, then what in heaven's name was it all about?
I wanted to find out where it was hidden, my dear fellow.
And did you?
Of course, I told you. Miss Adler showed me.
Showed you? Oh, come, Holmes.
My dear Watson, when a woman thinks that our house is on fire, she rushes for the one thing she values most. A married woman grabs her baby, an unmarried one her jewel box. In Miss Adler's case...
Ah, of course.
Exactly. The photograph is hidden in a recess behind a sliding panel close to the right-hand bell pull. I even caught a glimpse of it before she realized that the fire was a false alarm and thrust it back again.
And what'll you do now?
Send a telegram to His Majesty and have some dinner. Tomorrow morning we shall visit Bryony Lodge again. His Majesty will come with us. About 8 o'clock, before the lady is yet up, we shall be shown into the sitting room to await her. And when she comes down, she will find neither ourselves nor her photograph. No doubt it will delight the king to get it back with his own hands.
Wonderful, Holmes. It's a masterpiece. Wonderful. Well, here we are home again, or at least you are. I've still to get back to Paddington.
Oh, you would insist on getting married, Watson. But come in, won't you, while I take my disguise off and stay for a bite of dinner.
Good night, Mr. Sherlock Holmes.
What? Did you hear that, Watson?
What? Was a young man there going down the street?
Yes, yes, but I thought I recognized the voice. Something about its tone, you know.
Oh, no, just a passing acquaintance.
I dare say.
I am delighted, here, Holmes, quite delighted. I take back my suspicions about your lack of interest.
Your Majesty is very kind.
I presume all we have to do now
is to search the hidden panel while they go to fetch her. Simplicity itself.
I'll ring the bell.
And you tell me she is really married, Herr Holmes?
To the English lawyer named Norton. But here's her housekeeper.
Well, gentlemen.
Good morning. May we see Miss Irene Adler, please?
You are Monsieur Sherlock Holmes, I presume.
I am. How did you know that, pray?
My mistress told me to expect you. She left with her husband by the 5:15 from Charing Cross to the continent.
She's left England?
For good, monsieur.
Herr Holmes, the photograph.
Quickly, through this way.
Monsieur, then they want it.
Great heavens, Watson, she can't be gone.
Looks like it. Look, there's the panel you mentioned.
Yeah.
Open and empty.
No, doctor. Look, there's something still there.
Ah.
The photograph itself.
What? No. It's a different photograph, Your Majesty.
Different? Yes. Look, sir. A photograph of Miss Adler alone. Without your hand in hers.
Oh, goddess villain. What does it mean, Herr Holmes?
Why, she's actually fooled me. Me, Sherlock Holmes. Oh, there's a letter too, Watson, with my name on it, dated midnight.
Here, Mr. Sherlock Holmes. You really did it very well. I had been warned against you and told that if the king employed an agent, it would certainly be you. Even after I had shown you what you wanted to know, I still found it hard to think evil of such a dear and kind old clergyman. But I have been trained as an actress myself, you know. Male costume is nothing new to me. I slipped it on as quickly as I could while the bomb still smoked, and followed you and your friend to Baker Street, and so made sure I really was an object of interest to the great Mr. Sherlock Holmes. I even imprudently wished you good night.
Of course, that boy who passed us in the street.
My husband and I both thought that flight was best when faced with so formidable an antagonist.
Thank you.
As to the photograph, your client may rest in peace. I love a man better than he ever was, and suddenly decided this very morning to agree to his proposal of marriage. Did you know that, too? I wonder, Mr. Holmes. I only kept the wretched photograph to safeguard myself, but I give your client my assurance that I will never use it. I leave instead another photograph of myself alone for him to keep as a memento. And I remain, dear Mr. Sherlock Holmes, very truly yours, Irene Norton, née Adler.
What a woman, what a woman. She would have made such a queen if she had only been on my level.
Yes, from what I've seen, she's indeed on a very different level from you, Your Majesty.
Oh, you failed, Holmes.
What?
For once, you've failed.
No, Herr Doctor. She will not break her word. She will never trouble me again. I am safe.
I am relieved to hear Your Majesty say so.
Pray tell me in what way I can reward you, sir. This emerald ring.
Oh, thank you, but Your Majesty has something that I should value even more highly.
What then?
That photograph, sir.
Irene's? Ah, certainly, Herr Holmes.
I am very much obliged to Your Majesty. I have the honor to wish you a very good morning.
Well. And that was how a great scandal threatened the kingdom of Bohemia, and how the clever plans of Mr. Sherlock Holmes were beaten by a woman's wit. But sometimes he glances at that photograph upon his table, and then he speaks of her always with such affectionate admiration.
The woman, Watson. The woman.